What's up, crew? So I am taking you on a trip the next few days. I am on my way to Arizona for one of our retreats. So our Trailblazer Collective is kind of like our founder peer group mastermind, if you will. And we have about 15-ish people coming into town. We rented a big house and we're gonna be working on our businesses for the next few days. Some fun going on some hikes and really kind of connecting to level up going into the second half of this year. So in this video, I really wanted to bring you along for the ride, share lessons that are happening along the way, and also talk a little bit about why we do retreats, the power of kind of getting together in person, and yeah, just kind of try a different type of video, vlog, if you will. So let's get it going. So why do we call our peer group and our mastermind the Trailblazer Collective? I believe that we are at a moment in history where the lines between being an agency, professional service provider, to all the way on the other side of the spectrum, being a SaaS product or even a physical product, the lines between those two are getting closer and closer and blurrier and blurrier. The difference between a consultant, an agency, a facilitator, a tech-enabled service, those lines, again, are so blurry. And that's an advantage to you watching, because all of these things allow us to find unique and different ways to deliver the outcome, deliver the promise to our ideal clients. And if we think about professional services and why we see a shift towards kind of productization and how do you position your service as an outcome is because people want outcomes. It's easier to understand. It's an easier promise to typically make. And it's also often shortens the sales cycle. And so instead of saying, hey, we'll do all of these things, we say, hey, we solve this specific problem for this specific person. And you're able to go get clients in a more simple fashion. Delivery becomes simpler because you can get really good over and over and over, et cetera. So the premise behind an alt agency, an alternative agency, is leveraging the fact that there is such a blur between all of these different ways in which you can actually serve your client and becoming delivery agnostic. And so you're gonna have clients that want what you have, but either can't afford you, or they might have internal staff, or they might be willing to do the labor themselves, but they might not have the knowledge. And if all you ever sell is your time for money to do the work for them, you're missing out on tremendous opportunity to monetize your expertise. And so an alt agency is an expert, is someone that knows how to solve problems, but has packaged up their intellectual property, their process, into a variety of income streams that allow them to serve their clients in a variety of ways that meets clients where they're at and gives their clients exactly what they need. And so that means you can't just sell an open-ended retainer that is you doing the work for everybody. It means you need to have your core service, you need to offer training, you will probably eventually have knowledge products like books, courses, templates, and worksheets. You probably facilitate workshops and in-person events. You might host a mastermind for your ideal clients. And so an alt agency has these multiple income streams. And what I'm seeing time and time again is the agency owners that are tapping into this and using this to their advantage now are actually trailblazing inside of their industry. Time and time again, we're seeing our clients have their clients say things like, oh my God, thank you for having this way to work with us. It suits our needs. And we were going to bring this in-house, but now you can help us bring this in-house, and that extends the relationship for another 6 to 12 months, extending the lifetime value. And your industry, your ideal client, might just need a refresh. And you coming in and doing things differently, having a different perspective and a different point of view, and different ways to actually get them the outcome that they want, that are in more alignment with their needs, their budget, and quite frankly, their way of working, will be an advantage to you. Now, you can definitely go overboard and still offer too many things, which is a common challenge for agency owners, but you will see, mark my words, in the next 3 to 5 years, some of the most successful agencies, the ones that survive, honestly, will be the ones that have multiple income streams, all built off of their core intellectual property. Because your process, once packaged, becomes a product, and a product is property, and it's your intellectual property. That has value. And so a lot of our clients, these trailblazers, they are finding new ways to serve their market, which is creating new income streams that allow them to serve more people without having to go hire a ton more help. So if you come from the agency background like I have, where I was in agencies that had 200 to 400 people and it was chaotic, and you don't want that. You don't want to have a team of 20, 30, 50 plus people, but you still want to serve a lot of people at a high level, and you still want to raise the ceiling on your income, there's still an opportunity for you. And licensing your intellectual property, selling your IP in the form of knowledge products, training, workshops, allow you to serve clients in a leveraged format, a one-to-many format. We have clients that host workshops where people pay $5,000 for the workshop and they throw 25 people in the room and it's a one-day event. That's a really good turnout for one day of your time without having to go hire, you know, five new employees just to serve the next five new clients. So when we call this program Trailblazer Collective, we did it intentionally because we really only want to help the agencies and the consultants and the service providers that are tapping into the fact that there are better ways and more leveraged ways to get clients' results. And if you want to tap into that, then this is the right group for you. If you want to just sell your time for money and you want to just build an agency that has, you know, hundreds of employees, that's great. You're not for us. We're looking to innovate. More and more services are becoming like products. That is to your advantage, not a disadvantage. Tools like AI are an advantage, not a disadvantage. They can help you. They will not hurt you, assuming you leverage them in the right way. So if you're looking to blaze a new trail in your industry, become a known authority, a thought leader, have multiple ways to get paid for your thinking, your expertise, your intellectual property, not just your core service, then I'd love to connect with you. I'll drop a link below this video. You can always schedule a call with our team, but you gotta wanna blaze a trail. You gotta wanna innovate. You gotta wanna do things differently. You wanna have to be willing to educate your market and your ideal client profile on the changes and trends and things that are happening in your industry for them to get ahead. Right? You have to be willing to create content and put your face and name out there, because your content, your process combined, is your intellectual property. It's what creates authority. So that's what the Trailblazer Collective is all about. That's why we call it the Trailblazer Collective. Anyway, getting ready to board this plane. We'll see you in the house that we rented when we get there. And again, hope you enjoy the rest of the behind the scenes. Guys, this is officially day one. Early morning, little trail hike with the Trailblazer Collective. The great thing I love about getting people outside, one is the moments in between where you have everyone walking here together. You end up naturally just falling into a conversation. In a 2-3 mile hike, you end up talking to almost everybody, and you get to know what's on their mind, a little bit about them, what's going on in their world, so that when we get to sitting around a table, breaking bread and having conversations around our business growth, that you're able to kind of approach the conversation in a way where you actually know the person. The feedback you give, you kind of start to understand how it might impact their life, their family, their current lifestyle, because you get to know each other really, really well when you're out here sweating together, going up and down hills and mountains and trails, trying not to get bitten by a snake or a spider or something. This is the first morning. Tomorrow we got a trail run kind of in the same area, but after this little hike, we're gonna eat some breakfast and then we're gonna head back to the house. I'm gonna be talking about some key frameworks and models for everyone to kind of come into the rest of the year to continue to kind of be more agile inside of their business, not only acquire customers, but have members and clients as well. So not be bound to just selling time for money. So this sign is clearly not for us. Might have to take this sign down actually. So what's really cool is we have a wide range of business owners. We have a team of coaches and consultants from Spain that are doing six figures a month. They have an event coming up in Spain where they're gonna have 600 prospects in the room where they teach and train for a couple days and sell their two coaching programs. We have a consultant who led a company to go from 20 million to 150 million, just came out with a best-selling book, building out his own consulting and group training practice. We have an outbound lead generation agency. We have a Facebook ads agency that helps people get clients using paid ads. We have a funnel builder who helps course creators and info product entrepreneurs acquire customers using low ticket funnels. We have an agency that does amazing work with nonprofits in the faith-based space, helping them raise funding and donations through integrated marketing efforts. We have people helping consumers like you and I, people to have their dream home built in a very effective way, navigate all the ups and downs all around and the challenges that come with, you know, home building. So we have a wide range of service providers and agencies that are here really to build a better business, a business that is more leveraged, that can run without them, the founder, inside the day-to-day, but as much as possible is monetizing and leveraging their expertise, their intellectual property, not just selling their time for money, their services. It's great to obviously offer services, but when your services are more like a product, being able to delegate, being able to systematize, being able to productize, being able to quote unquote scale more effectively becomes simpler. And also it leaves people with, in more cases than not, a business that they love, a business that doesn't require a ton of employees, not that they're trying to be solopreneurs, but they, a small, lean and mean team, 5, 10, 15 people can really help you run a business that is 6, 7 figures of profit in today's world, as long as it's maximizing and monetizing your intellectual property. So after this hike, I'm going to be breaking down some frameworks on how to think about unpacking your intellectual property, what products and services you should actually have in your service suite so that you can cater to a wide range of buyers, the 3 different types of buyers in your buyer segment within your ICP, your ideal client profile. We'll keep bringing you along for the ride. Hope you're enjoying. Leave a comment below if this sort of content is interesting. And obviously, if you're an agency owner and you're, you know, trying to grow and become the thought leader and monetize your IP, let us know. Links in the comments. We'd love to have a chat. All of us have expertise. Some of us have tools that we've built. Some of us have off-the-shelf tools that we can leverage. If we're not tapping into those ourselves, we're leaving ourselves at a disadvantage. The types of outcomes that people want might require them to be a client, a member, or a customer. The type of expertise you have and how it complements your core capability might dictate what happens in clients, members, customers. And that's why it's like so moldable. But the number to start thinking about, like, if you have your offer that is for clients, you know, say it's a 90-day for 35K, and then you have like a, you know, a member type offer that is 5K for 90 days, and then you have a book, right? Like, and you're like, I want to get to a million. Well, it's like, okay, how many clients do you need? How many members do you need? How many books do you need to sell? You can kind of have like a, at one point I was saying like 10, 100, 1,000. Like 10 clients that are worth over 50K a year, 100 members that are worth anywhere from, you know, 5 to 15K a year to 1,000 customers from $5 to $50, whatever that looks like, you might be 100 members away from the dream business. You might be 10 clients away from the dream business. You might be 1,000 customers away from your dream business. Once you figure out what your price points are, you can figure out, well, how many do I want at this level? And if reverse engineer, okay, I need X members, I need X clients, so on and so forth. So your numbers might look different. It might be 5, 50, 500, whatever. So obviously we know clients. I actually did a dotted line here because I'm trying to make a distinction between, this is kind of bespoke typically, like your client work is like, whether it's one-on-one, more customized, more bespoke, like high effort, low volume. And historically I've been putting client members and then customers. I'm playing with, we'll see how you guys like this, subscribers. Because some of you guys have like a service, like it's still like more of like a productized service. Yes, they're probably technically clients, but like when you look at a lot of the language that's happening in the marketplace right now, like there's books about subscription as a service or service as a subscription, the book Subscribe, the book Range. All these books are like talking about all these companies that have taken services and turned them into like Design Pickle. Like it's a productized service. You're not a client, really. To me, program is like you're a member of a program. And so kind of like distinguishing like training versus still service oriented, if you feel like you need that distinction and that becomes helpful for you. If that makes it more confusing, pick the one that you like. But to me, subscribers is still a systematic service, whereas members is like membership, community, programmatic versus like systematic. Programmatic meaning you're tapping into IP, we're using content as leverage, things like that. Is that making sense? All right, so We're basically the end of the mastermind. Everybody has left the house. We came in on a Wednesday afternoon, spent Thursday, Friday together. We did hikes, trail run, had some light training, and a whole lot of masterminding, which there were a lot of different breakthroughs for the clients that were here. We have clients that are going through leadership challenges where they're trying to step up as a leader and try to get their team to step up as leaders and putting in operational communication cadences like quarterly planning, monthly all hands, weekly touch points, and daily touch points that work for them. We have some clients that love meetings, some clients that don't like meetings, really kind of sharing our operational playbook with each and every member on how they could kind of apply it and cater it and modify it to their needs to better communicate with their team, keep their team moving forward with alignment and making sure that they're hitting their goals and staying focused on the specific metrics that are going to move their business forward. We had other clients that are launching new complimentary offers, others that are reimagining their business and modifying who they serve and exactly how they're going to deliver the outcome to their clients. A lot of really cool businesses and clients that came together and were extremely vulnerable, sharing what's going on in their world, both in their personal life and their business life, lessons, wins, failures that have allowed them to get to the level they're at, but also come from a place of how can I serve the next person in the room? So we're never as smart as the entire room. And so when you can get your clients and when we get our clients together in a room for a couple days, there's just a lot of clarity, aha, and a sense of belonging and community to happen. So it was really awesome to see. For those of you that have been following along on this journey, historically we were hosting events at hotels and conference rooms. And this time we rented this beautiful house here in Arizona. Some clients stayed on site. Some clients were right down the street. And we ate around the fire. We ate around the pool. Plenty of time for conversation, getting to know one another. And once you actually know what drives someone, what their purpose is, and really just get to know them, you're able to provide insights and share your own experiences that unlock opportunity, possibility for someone else in a way where I'll say, like, it's not malpractice, right? Sometimes it's easy to give blind advice when you don't know the full context. And when you spend 2.5 days with someone diving deep and being willing to be vulnerable and share, you know, what's working, what's not working, the pretty, the ugly, you can actually start to make a lot of progress with folks. In fact, I want to share just a couple takeaways from clients that clients shared with us. So let's check out what a few people had to say.
So I was hesitant coming to the event, honestly, because I'm so busy and I didn't know if it'd be worth the time. But when I got here, it was pretty obvious within the first hour of meeting everybody that this was gonna be a pretty amazing event. And it didn't disappoint. We went through a lot of business stuff and some of the responses to some of the problems that we were having were exceptional responses. And I think there were a lot of takeaways that people had from it. And so the time was extremely well spent because I have like 15, 16 action items to go home with now.
What I liked about the event is that Greg asked great questions. He's inclusive, brings a group in. He also does a bit of teaching, but a little bit of mindset work, some systems and models that really, even though I've heard some of this before in his programs, to bring it into the room and then bring it to life, and then also allow other people who are at the group to be able to react to that and ask questions. It really helped me to light up some light bulbs of things that I hadn't actually realized before. And I didn't put these sort of pieces together in a way that I have today and over these last couple days. And so I'm very grateful for this experience because not only is it great people, great content, but I've actually had some really big ahas while I've been here.
Really liked, that it was intimate, that it wasn't a massive group, that it wasn't at, you know, a hotel lobby / conference room where you're stuck inside all day, just kind of like, you know, being in the dark. There's a pool behind me that is clean, although there's leaves in it, and just had a great time, you know, meeting lots of other like-minded people that not only do they have similar sort of businesses, but very similar goals, which is really important.
This was a really interesting one for us. We're used to like big events with hundreds of other agencies in a room, and to have all of the like the craziness of an event like that stripped away and just have those intimate conversations that are just real and powerful, like that's where the magic happens. And I think that Alt did such a good job of taking the idea of having an intimate event and making it loose, but intentionally loose, because it was more customized to everybody that was here. And we were able to workshop together in a small group in a true mastermind form. And that's something that I don't like, it doesn't exist anywhere else. And to have something like that was extremely powerful.
So now that you heard what they had to say, what I wanted to share is just a couple key takeaways that I noticed from the group and things that I learned personally. So the first thing is that many of us, as we're growing our business, whether you're a solo owner and you have a team of fractional or freelance consultants, or you're in the process of growing your team and you might have 3, 4, 5, 10 people, you have to spend time focusing on leadership. And a book that I really recommend is Radical Candor. And a lot of us talked about how can you lead your team without being a dictator, but also being stern and creating a standard. One thing that seemed to touch every single person in the room the last 2 days was, at some stage or another in your business, you as the leader never defined what the standard is, meaning what does success look like? How do we operate? What do I tolerate? What do I not tolerate? And when that goes on long enough, sometimes team members that had never been provided a standard or boundaries will create their own. Sometimes that leads to you as a founder feeling like you are handcuffed by some of your team members, which actually was a common theme from a few people, so much so that maybe you feel like, what would I do if I lost this person? Or if I try to get this person back on track, are they gonna wanna leave? Is the business I'm building big enough for what this person wants to achieve in their life? The group shared tons of amazing tactics and strategies on getting your team aligned, creating a clear vision as the founder, how to communicate that vision to your team so that everyone's on the same page and you can make sure that you have the right people in the right seat in your company. So that was a common theme across the room. The second thing that was pretty much top of mind for everybody was the shift in the market from lead generation to brand authority building and customer acquisition. How do you demonstrate your expertise to your ideal client target so that they can get a taste for what you do? Whether that's through free content, like leveraging YouTube, we went really deep down how we at our business leverage videos like this and YouTube to drive leads, drive sales conversations, and bring on our ideal clients, to hosting in-person workshops that are both free and or paid to bring your ideal clients together into a room and add value while also enrolling them into your programs and your services, and just the power of content like this in general. Most of our clients are really active on at least one or two platforms, Instagram, LinkedIn, and the daily thought leadership, the sharing of your point of view, is what is going to attract a lot of your ideal clients. If you're out there saying the exact same thing as everybody else, you're not necessarily gonna stand out in your market. And so having and actively and frequently communicating your point of view, which will often attract the right people, but also kind of deflect the people that you would never want to work with, is really critical in today's marketing landscape. So keep developing your point of view. Make sure you're actively communicating and sharing that point of view on your platforms of choice with as high of a cadence as possible, because at the end of the day, conversions happen in conversations, and your content is a really great way to join a conversation that's already happening with your ideal client, like join the conversation that they're already having inside their head, but then also through calls to action and commenting and warm outreach from your content, you can start having conversations with people that have been following you, engaging with specific pieces of content, and move those people into a conversation to potentially get them into your sales process. So actively sharing your point of view and leveraging your social media platform of choice and growing your audience is top of mind for a lot of folks right now. And I think it should be for you as well. Another common theme across the last 2 days was the fact that we go through seasons in business. And when you're in a growth phase, a lot of things will actually break. And sometimes you will have to, as a leader, slow the plane down and go into a little bit of an optimization phase. Meaning maybe the people that got you to where you're at aren't gonna be the people that are gonna get you to where you're going. Or now, having worked with a lot of clients, you realize that there's a lot of improvements that need to be made to how you deliver your service, and you need to go into kind of optimization of your actual products and services, maybe killing certain offers, introducing new ways to support your clients hit their goals. And you kind of move through this cycle of growth, to then, all right, things are breaking. We need to clean this up in order to grow. We go into an optimization phase, and we want to make sure that that optimization phase is as short as possible. And inside of the optimization phase, you have to really quickly recalibrate your vision for what the next level is so that you can then go back into growth mode. And oftentimes, early stage founders, we were afraid to stop the growth because we think that the growth will end, and we never take care of the optimization that is going to allow us to get to the next level. And so you end up burning out because things are breaking. Clients, if you're trying to just scale, and you're not optimizing your team or the delivery experience, and all you're caring about is new sales, you're likely going to get to a point where you're bringing in some of the wrong clients, and thus they're not getting what was promised, and the right clients aren't getting appropriately served. And so you might start to experience some high churn. And the business economics of that can only go so long before you really start to feel it in your back pocket, and it creates a lot of stress. And so sometimes, like I said, you have to pull out of growth mode and go into optimization mode. And again, get really clear on where you're going, then re-enroll the team and help the team see very clearly, hey, here's where we're going, here's how everyone fits into the puzzle and or doesn't fit into the puzzle, so that we can get back into growth mode and keep growing. Because the old adage or old saying of if you're not growing, you're dying, I do think holds merit to some degree, but there obviously is time for optimization and we have to tweak and refine things. So if you're in a stage where you feel like you're burning out and things are not necessarily moving forward, you might need to look at your business and have an honest conversation with yourself and ask, do I need to go into some sort of optimization? Do I have the right team for where we're at right now? Do we have the right clients? Is the service that we're delivering the service that it actually should be? Or do we need to modify and improve over there? Is our marketing message continuing to attract the right people? These are all things that could be tweaked and optimized in the optimization phase. And if you're in the optimization phase, it's very difficult to be also growing at the same time. If you're trying to grow and optimize, you're usually not dedicating enough mental brain power and energy and bandwidth to solving the problem at hand, and it'll just drag on and on and on and likely continue to burn you out. So that was another key topic. You know, are you in a growth phase or an optimization phase? And if so, it's okay to be in an optimization phase, but let's try to keep that optimization phase as short as possible. Now, the last piece that came up, which I talked about earlier in this video, is really continuing to develop and evolve into what we call an alt agency, where you have at least three different income streams. You have clients at your highest level, which is typically your service. You have members or subscribers, which are likely a productized service or some sort of program membership, and then eventually customers, where you're unpacking intellectual property from all of your experience and work that you've done with clients to create other offerings that set you up to be a little bit more delivery agnostic, meaning your clients might need the outcome that you have, but they might not need it delivered to them the way that you normally would want it to be delivered. So you might be adding training to your offer suite. You might be writing a book or creating workshops that help educate and nurture your ideal client in the stage of business that they're in to eventually become a customer for something else. Or you might be training your client how to do what you do in-house because they've grown to a level where it makes sense for those activities and services to actually be inside their business. And so depending upon who you serve and what you sell, we have a lot of clients that have been increasing their lifetime value with their client by simply starting to educate and train their clients' internal staff on how to deploy a lot of the systems that they had created, which the alternative would have been they just got fired or they got let go because the client wanted to bring it in-house. They've extended their relationship by 6 to 12 months because the client actually wants to be trained and weaponized to know what to do, and who better to do that than you, the person that's been doing it. So we have a lot of clients that have been kind of expanding the amount of income streams inside of their business and dealing with, again, the optimization of their core services and their pricing and things like that, so that they don't have to play the traditional agency growth game of, okay, well, in order to get the next 10 clients, which would allow us to double, I'm also going to need to now go hire 4 people. And there's this kind of cat and mouse game that a lot of agency owners play, and they think that the only alternative or the only option to grow is hire more people and get more clients. And for most of the agencies that I come across, they want to, as much as they can, minimize the amount of overhead and the stress and overwhelm that comes from managing a very large team. And so when you actually start to unpack your process and your intellectual property, you can remain lean as possible. So small team, big profit, small team, big revenue, small team, big impact. All those things actually start to become way more possible when you think of how many people do I need at my client level? How many members do I need at my member level? And how many customers do I need to serve over the course of a year to hit my financial targets? And so instead of just growing by getting more clients, which is, you know, more of the custom bespoke, hands-on, high-touch work, it's how do I codify and monetize my intellectual property and scale through customers and selling my knowledge and getting paid for my thinking versus just only selling my labor through services. So big common theme, obviously that's what we're primarily about here is productizing your service and then scaling and monetizing your intellectual property. So a lot of our clients that have already begun doing that, we're sharing their experience with how they got their first few clients, all the way to the people that are now veterans in having multiple income streams and have just released best-selling books and are filling out, you know, huge conference rooms to deliver training and events and workshops to, you know, 600 members. So really, really amazing to spend 2.5 days with some of the best people, brightest people in the agency and consulting space that are really trying to blaze a new trail with how they serve their market. If you're in a market where you're being kind of commoditized and you look like everybody else, oftentimes being different is actually better than just being better. Obviously, you want to always deliver on your promises and be great at what you do, but sometimes just approaching how you serve your ideal clients and the packaging of your service and your point of view makes you stand out from the crowd. And so that's what we really want to help people do here at Alt Agency is become a trailblazer, help their clients get results in ways where you meet them where they're at, not just be a one-dimensional service provider. So I hope you guys again enjoyed this video. I wanna know what your biggest takeaway is in the comments below. And also, did you like this style of video? I can hopefully do more of these if you guys like it. And obviously we'll bring you behind the scenes at the next event.